My name's Libby. I am a trustee with the charity, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Perry Elliott, who really kind of needs no introduction, except to say that he is a consultant cardiologist at Barts Heart Centre and a professor of cardiovascular medicine at UCL. That'll do. Near enough. Okay. So this session, I hope you're in the right room. This session is about new drug treatments. And what we're going to do is we're going to sort of split it 20-20-20 so that Professor Elliott will talk for about 20 minutes. And then he and I are going to have a little chat with some questions that I think, I hope, will be relevant to everybody. And then when we've done that, we'll open out questions to the floor. So thank you very much, Professor Elliott. Over to you.
Right, so now in the last one I was told I was speaking too quietly. So now I shall enunciate and speak very loudly. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Good. Okay, so what I'm going to do for, you say 20 minutes?
Or thereabouts.
Approximately. Is to talk about, I suppose, what we regard as being current standard of care, and then give you some insights into what's happening in our thinking for new therapies. And has come up several times during this meeting already, I genuinely think that we're about to enter a brand new era in the therapeutics of all cardiomyopathies. And I'll try to explain why I say that in a second. But part of it is this. I mean, I'm sure you've heard personalised medicine, okay? What does that really mean? Well, there's a blah, blah, blah definition of personalised medicine. But in essence, what it is defining to a greater level of sophistication and certainty what the mechanisms of disease are, and then targeting those mechanisms to get better results in individual patients. And this is a slide, if you like, which uses a paradigm from cancer, where I would say that probably there have been some of the greatest advances in personalized medicine so far. At the present time, or up until very recently, the way in which we treated cancer was to say, okay, you have a colon cancer. We're going to treat that with a standard therapy. And what we have known for a long time happens is that some people will get better, some people it will be sort of ineffective, and some people will actually be made sicker by the treatment. The rationale behind personalized medicine is that we realize that tumors are very different, even in the same location. And if we can understand those differences, we can develop a broader range of treatments which have a better chance of harmonizing the response to therapy, so we get more people responding than not. So when we talk about lung cancer, we don't talk about one disease anymore. We talk about diseases which are defined by abnormal genetics at a tissue level. So these are not genes that you inherit. These are genetic mutations that arise in the tissue and give rise to a cancer. But there are many of those different types of genetic mutations that do so. And there are now specific therapies for many of these genetic subtypes of cancer. Indeed, if you look at this slide, this is sort of over a period of 2 or 3 years, the number of new cancer drugs being licensed for specific types, subtypes of tumor. Now, if we segue back to cardiovascular disease, it seems like a long time ago now, but it wasn't that long. It's an article in 2018, where it was recognized that personalized medicine has enormous potential in cardiovascular disease, but it's yet to make much headway. Now, why is that? Well, one of the reasons is this. Now, when people talk about personalized medicine, they get a little bit carried away. And we end up with these sort of incredible maps of, so we're going to do robotics and all this. I can tell you now, these kind of diagrams are drawn up by people who've never seen, smelt, touched, or seen a patient. Yes, there is an enormous amount of technology that we can use to personalize our treatments. But this is so far from reality, it's untrue. What I'd like to argue is that I think cardiomyopathies actually present us with an ideal model for personalised medicine. But let's just talk about what we do at the moment. So for 60 years now, when we talk about cardiomyopathy, we just describe what we see when we take a picture of the heart. So if the heart muscle is thick, we call it hypertrophic. If the ventricle is dilated and poorly functioning, we call it dilated, and so on. So these are purely descriptive terms. A few years ago, we said, well, let's add another layer of to this classification of disease. And are we dealing with genetic or non-genetic disease? This is hardly a classification, but it was more an aid memoir, a prompt to doctors to think about genetic disease. But of course, what we now realize is that whatever cardiomyopathy type you're dealing with, HCM, DCM, etc., we're dealing with families of conditions caused by mutations in all of the proteins, pretty much, that can make up different components of the heart muscle cell. From what we call the cell membrane on the outside, to the contractile apparatus, to the bits that hold all that together. You know, many, many different genes and many, many different mutations can cause these different cardiomyopathy subtypes. So that offers us the possibility of specific therapies, but actually what we do at the moment is that we focus on what we regard as being the headline problems, and that's appropriate. So in all cardiomyopathy subtypes, we want to identify that small group of people who are at risk of dying suddenly. We want to try, if we can, to prevent or slow down progression of heart failure. And this is atrial fibrillation and stroke. We want to treat that if we can. And the paradigm for each of the different cardiomyopathies is a little different. So this is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Oh, no, that didn't play. But thick heart. And what we do at the moment is that we make an assessment of symptoms. You know, if people have got obstruction, we try to relieve the symptoms related to obstruction. AF, we try to prevent. Anticoagulate to prevent stroke if we can. One thing that we're not very good at is progression of heart failure in HCM. We've got good therapies to prevent sudden death, so in the form of defibrillators. We can treat outflow tract obstruction with drugs or surgery or alcohol ablation. And with stroke, as I say, we know that it's atrial fibrillation is the cause for stroke in most people. We can identify people who are at risk, anticoagulate and reduce the risk of stroke. Over a lifetime, yes, you can get sudden death, but the main problems are heart failure and atrial fibrillation. But everything I've shown you pretty much is based on observation and not on trials. This is an area of cardiology, unusually in cardiology, where we've had very few clinical trials. And there are various reasons for that. But the paradigm for HCM has been, we've studied lots of people, we've done very few trials. When we give treatments, it's mostly on the basis of consensus. So experts saying this is what we think is the right thing to do. But at the moment, we're very good at treating obstruction. We're very good at preventing sudden death. We can do things with AF, but we do nothing to prevent progressive disease. That's HCM. The story is very different in dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, in dilated cardiomyopathy, we have trials coming out of our ears. We've got a lot of trials in people with heart failure for different causes, including DCM, where we've shown that drugs such as ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, spironolactone, particular types of pacing, cardiac resynchronization therapy, defibrillators, these have all been shown in clinical trials to improve outcomes. And as a consequence, what we've seen over since the 1970s onwards is steady improvement in outcomes for all comers with DCM. So this is the survival curve for people in the 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s. And this is all the impact of these evidence-based drug therapies predominantly. What's been missing from dilated cardiomyopathy is sort of an understanding and an application of what we understand about the genetics of DCM. Because DCM is like HCM. It's not one condition, it's a family of different conditions. And if you look hard enough within the noise, within these improvements in survival, there are some other stories that have been overlooked. So if you compare the survival, this is dilated cardiomyopathy, patients who don't have an identifiable genetic mutation compared to those who do, and this is the incidence of sudden death or ventricular arrhythmia, if you carry a mutation, you've got a higher risk than if you don't. But most of that is driven by mutations in very particular genes. Genes, there's one called lamin, another one called desmoplakin, another one called LBM20. The names don't matter. Your risk depends on the underlying cause, and particularly on the underlying genetic abnormality. So the paradigm for dilated cardiomyopathy is actually we've got tons of trials, in contrast to HCM. We do have very effective medicines, but there's very few, if any, studies that target the underlying cause of DCM. So why don't we do that? And this is a culture change problem. Now, I'm not seeking to change your mind, but I'm trying to get you to change your cardiologist's minds. Because what we've been doing for 20, 30 years with all these drugs and pacemakers and defibrillators has been very successful. So being cardiologists, we tend to, we're humble people, as I'm sure you realize, but we're very proud of what we've done. But what I'm trying to show you is that within the noise, there are groups of patients who are not doing so well with modern therapies. But to persuade cardiovascular medicine to adopt a strategy built around determining the cause, why should I as a cardiologist learn about genetics so I can apply it in my clinic? You've got to show that it makes a difference. And that's why I now talk about actionability. I used to talk about rare disease a lot, rare causes of cardiomyopathy. I don't use the word rare anymore. Because if I use that word, doctors' minds turn off. Or if it's rare, I don't need to know about that. So what I talk about now are actionable diagnoses. Now, actionability has to be over and above what we already do. So we're still going to be treating atrial fibrillation, ventricular arrhythmias, heart failure, valve disease in the same way as we do now. Until very recently, the sort of the cardiomyopathy bit on top of that was very much around, well, maybe a few defibrillators, about lifestyle, don't exercise too much, that screen your family. But already within medicine and other areas, getting a genetic diagnosis will fundamentally change how you're treated. So one of the commonest genetic disorders in the population is something called familial hypercholesterolemia, a raised cholesterol. And for that, we already have therapies which are designed to target the underlying genetic cause of that. We're now talking about gene therapies to correct the genetic abnormality that results in familial hypercholesterolemia. That's established. What I call the poster child for cardiomyopathy for heart muscle disease has been this condition. I mentioned this a lot in the HoCM session this morning, but it's a group of conditions that are called amyloidosis. Now, amyloid is different types of protein laid down in the heart muscle, which makes it thick and stiff and causes heart failure. And as a group of conditions, they're actually quite common. So if you look at people with, there's a thing called heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So you've got heart failure symptoms, you measure the pump function, it's within the normal range, so the heart's stiff. Often attributed to high blood pressure and things like that. But if you go looking for this condition amongst people with that, maybe as much as 10 or 15% of people have this condition. And why is it now important? Because there's now a specific treatment for it. The commonest form of amyloid is caused by deposition of a protein that's made by the liver. And what happens to this protein is it breaks up and then the parts reaccumulate within the heart. What we now have is a drug which prevents this breakup. And that drug is called tafamidis. And in this randomized trial in people with an average age of 75, there was a 30% reduction in mortality. This is the first time in heart muscle disease heart failure where we've targeted a specific cause and shown a benefit. Most of the drugs we use, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, treat the downstream effects. They don't treat the underlying driver to disease. This was the first example of that. So what we're moving to now is the more common or garden forms of hypertrophic of cardiomyopathy. And this is looking at the apparatus that makes the heart contract. If you look at the heart, it has these structures called sarcomeres, which are basically filaments that slide across one another like this. And that's caused by the interaction of proteins like this one, which is beta-myosin heavy chain and actin. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, some people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, this system is too active. So these proteins hang on to each other for too long, and that drives thickening of the heart. So people reasonably say, well, what if we give a drug or do something to lessen this interaction? And there is a drug that does that now called mavacamten, which you've heard a lot about at this meeting. We're going to talk about that in a second, which reduces this contractility like so. So this is sort of heart muscle contracting. It reduces with this drug. But what we now have, horror of horrors, is a randomized clinical controlled trial using this drug in people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy who have obstruction. And the headline is that it reduces the obstruction, reduces your symptoms, reduces the stress on the heart muscle. Now, the way that drug is working in that context is to sort of reduce the force of contraction of the heart. But mavacamten and drugs like mavacamten, because there are others coming along now as well, one called aficamten, do other things as well. Not only do they reduce this hypercontractility problem, they also improve the relaxation of the heart. And we don't really have many drugs that do that. So now there's an interest in using drugs like mavacamten in people who don't have obstruction, who just have a stiff heart. And this was a sort of what we call a phase two trial of mavacamten in non-obstructive disease. And here the response was more mixed, but there were in some patients improvement in symptoms, and there were also reductions of substances in the blood, hormones in the blood, which tell us that the heart is under stress. And there's now a randomized trial starting in non-obstructive disease with mavacamten. Now, the way that drug works is, I say, to sort of inhibit things in the sarcomere, the contractile apparatus. But for people with dilated cardiomyopathy, what if we gave a drug which made that system more effective? And those kind of drugs do exist. These are called sensitizers. And there are now trials underway in using those drugs in people with dilated cardiomyopathy. And all of this development comes from an understanding of the underlying biology of, in this case, hypertrophic, but also in dilated cardiomyopathy. Where there's a lot of excitement, a lot of investment, is in gene therapy. So, can we correct genetic abnormalities? In theory, it is now possible to do so for some genetic mutations. So some genes, what they do is, if you have a mutation in that gene, you don't produce a particular protein. So what if we were to take a normal copy of that gene, get it into the cell, so it can then start producing that protein and restore normal function to the cell? And that is possible by delivering gene using viruses, not the kind of viruses we've been living with for the past 3 or 4 years, but what are called adenoviruses, which get into the cell, deliver the gene. And that is now being used in muscle disease. It's being used to treat hemophilia, to cure hemophilia. Because if you get the gene inside the cells, you've got enough factor VIII being produced. You don't need to give any more factor VIII. You're cured. It's being looked at in a number of metabolic diseases. The question is, can we correct genetic abnormalities in the heart itself? Now, genetic therapy, we've never done it before in the heart. We don't know what it's capable of. And there are some serious challenges. Getting the virus to the heart is quite hard. A lot of people have antibodies to these viruses, which means that if you give the gene therapy, it may not work. And there's also a few sort of new sort of ethical things we're going to have to think about with gene therapy. What this means is that when you're going to get a mixture of normal cells and abnormal cells in the heart, is that a good or a bad thing? We don't know. Are these genes just going to the heart muscle cells, or could they be going to other cells as well? So you get unwanted effects. They're going to be really expensive treatments. So who makes the decision as to which genes to target? Now, of course, we have this in our system, but in some healthcare economies, you know, you get what you pay for. So would gene therapy be a therapy for the rich and not the poor? You're changing God's genetic code. So there may be, you know, concerns there. Consent and heritability. If you change the genetic code in a person, they can then transmit that change to offspring. Now, we're arguing that it's a good thing to do because you're changing an abnormality, but consent, you know, issues about heritability to children. Again, these are things we're going to have to think through with gene therapy. Fortunately, I've been talking about getting a virus to deliver a new gene into a cell, but there are other ways of manipulating genetics. We can give genes that turn off the abnormality or bypass the abnormality. We can use the kind of technologies that have been used to develop COVID vaccines for this purpose. In fact, that's what companies like Moderna and so on were developing their platforms for gene therapy. And they adapted them for COVID vaccine. And these kind of therapies are already being used. They're being used again to treat amyloidosis. There's been a recent trial there about turning off the gene which makes that protein in the liver. There's a ton of different approaches being looked at the moment. So I think, you know, where we're heading really quite quickly is moving from, you know, drugs and things that we do which are very effective to maybe imagining in 5 years' time or 10 years' time, we're going to have a whole stack of other things. Drugs like mavacamten, what we call small molecule therapies, gene therapies, RNA technologies, which are going to be targeted at very specific genetic and maybe other types of heart muscle disease, like inflammatory disease, myocarditis. Whatever, I think you're going to see very quickly a change in the narrative from treating the consequences of these diseases to treating the underlying cause. I think it's going to be a really exciting, challenging, but exciting time. Thank you very much indeed.
So I just thought it'd be really nice if we had a slightly more relaxed Q&A session before we went to questions from the floor. And I think, Professor Elliott, I'm going to focus on mavacamten.
Sure.
Because it's the nearest one to being available for us. So we talk about treating symptoms, and historically with all the cardiomyopathies, we've been treating symptoms, but mavacamten is the first drug that's actually going to treat the cause of the disease. Mm. Do you think that this is the answer to all our hopes and dreams about treatment for HoCM?
It's the beginning of the answer.
It's the beginning.
So you're right, it treats the symptoms by reducing obstruction. But what we've already seen with the mavacamten trial is it's doing other things as well. There's a signal in the trial which suggests that maybe the wall thickness is reducing. Now, we need to confirm that. We need to understand that. Is it a good thing or a bad thing? But if that's happening, then for the first time, it's suggesting that maybe there's an element of reversibility in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which is something until very recently I would have said is nonsense. You know, once you've got a thick heart, you can't go backwards. Mm. But maybe you can. Mm. So I think the concept, which is common in other areas of medicine, like rheumatoid arthritis or whatever, of modifying the underlying disease, I think that's, with MAVA and aficamten and drugs like that, I think we're going to start seeing that concept, at least in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, where it's not just about holding the line, it's about possibly pushing the disease back a bit.
Yeah, sure. And you talked about the lack of randomized controlled trials.
Yeah.
So we now have one.
Yeah.
With more to come, yeah, obviously. But with the EXPLORER-HCM trial. So can you tell us a little bit about that trial, and was there anything in the results that stood out for you?
Okay, so this was people with obstruction, with symptoms, randomised to either a placebo or to mavacamten. The endpoint in the trial, so the thing that was used to judge whether the trial was effective, was a combination of improvement in symptoms and exercise capacity, measured on a bike or a treadmill. Now, I'll be honest with you, I was consulted along with many, many other people about whether they should use exercise testing as an endpoint in that trial. And I advised against it, because the relationship between how much you do on a bike or a treadmill and the severity of obstruction symptoms is actually not that tight. Okay. But actually, they demonstrated an incredible improvement in exercise capacity. Not in everybody. So it's not a panacea. So not everybody responded. But around a third of people had a very dramatic improvement. I think that was what the first surprise, I think. The second surprise was the response of hormones in the blood, which tell us that the heart is under stress. There's a hormone called BMP, there's another hormone called troponin. Both of those came down, actually, even when the very low doses of the drug was used. And that, again, to me, fits with something beyond reducing obstruction. It's doing something to reduce the stress within the cell beyond gradient reduction. So I think it's a very, very positive trial.
It's fantastic to have these big trials now, isn't it, that we haven't had before. In the write-up for that trial, it was interesting to note that people who had an identified genotype did better on mavacamten than those that didn't.
Yeah.
Why do you think that was?
So
I expect you to know the answers to all these.
That's fine. If I don't know them, I'll make them up. That's fine.
Okay.
So this is a slight making up one.
Okay.
So the drug was developed around an understanding of what the mutations do to these proteins. But actually, the way the trial was constructed, you gave the drug to everybody with HCM, irrespective of whether or not they had a genetic mutation or not, because the drug reduces contractility in everybody. But maybe the effect is most pronounced in those who've actually got a mutation which is amenable to the drug itself. So that's one possible explanation why it is. It may be that there's something different about the characteristics of the people who don't have a mutation. So maybe they've got disease which is perhaps more related to hypertension and other things which have thickened their heart muscle up, and giving MAVA is not going to treat those other contributors to the disease. So we don't know yet, but you're right. For me, it's probably about the mechanism of the drug.
Okay. And again, in the trial, it was the treatment period on MAVA was only about 30 weeks, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That's quite a short period of time, isn't it, to test the drug. Do we know anything yet about the long-term effects?
So there's a long-term extension to that study. So for people who were in the trial, everybody, irrespective of whether you were on the drug or placebo, was allowed to continue. So there are data being generated from the long-term extension.
Okay.
At the moment, it seems as though the effect is durable, so it doesn't wane with time. One thing that does happen is if you stop the drug, the symptoms come back.
You're preempting my question now.
I'm sorry. Which means that at least in that group of patients with obstruction, it is about, it's the same as a beta blocker in a sense. You know, you give a drug which reduces contractility, take away the drug, the contractility will come back. But whether you get a long-term remodeling effect, only time will tell.
So it's a lifetime therapy?
It's definitely a lifetime therapy. Yeah, without some other intervention to get rid of the obstruction, it's a lifetime therapy.
And we talked this morning about surgery.
Yeah.
With Mr. Cipollini, and there are some areas of the septum that you can't affect with surgery. Do you think MAVA would be useful in those patients to affect those areas?
Yeah, I think that's going to work both ways. So there are going to be some patients who are not good surgical candidates for whatever reason. It may be the anatomy, and there MAVA may be very helpful. Conversely, there may be people who've got anatomy which is not amenable to any drug therapy. So if they've got very long mitral valves, for example, then you could marinate them in the drug, but it's the anatomy which is the determinant of the obstruction. So some of my surgical colleagues, including Alex, were a little worried that they were going to be put out of business by
MAVA. Yeah, he said.
And I've told him it's going to be the reverse.
Okay.
Because I think what's going to happen is when the drug, if the drug becomes available, I think you're going to find a sort of a resurgence of interest amongst cardiologists saying, well, you've got obstruction, let's try this drug. And then we'll be developing pathways which will accelerate people from drug failure into surgery. So I think we're going to see a lot more people with obstruction referred to us.
Does that mean that people will be having surgery later in life?
What I would hope is going to happen is that in order, it's a little bit complex administering this drug, because each time you go up a dose, you have to do an echo.
Yeah.
And trying to do that in the existing NHS systems is not going to work. So we're going to have special pathways, special clinics for management of obstruction. Mm. And I think what that will do is actually accelerate treatment, drug therapy, but also, I hope, accelerate septal reduction therapies as well. Because what happens at the moment, as many of you have probably experienced, is you try one drug, then another, and by the time you get to making the decision of surgery, probably several years have passed.
Mm.
So I hope the whole pathway will be short.
Yeah, sure. And in people who have an identifiable gene but haven't yet expressed the disease, do you think it's possible to use mavacamten prophylactically to stop the hypertrophy actually starting?
Yeah. So as I was saying in the HoCM session this morning, if we're going to develop therapies that target the underlying cause, and if it's a gene that we're targeting, then the final destination, surely, is to be able to screen people. So you're carrying the mutation. We're going to give you something to prevent you from getting the disease.
Yeah.
That has to be the final goal.
Mm-hmm.
That's quite a journey. And I think that's a little way off yet.
How many years?
I'm going to be retired.
Okay.
So I'm not going to tell you
20.
How many years. No, I think we have, first of all, we've got to get gene therapy to work in those we know have got disease. All of the issues around ethics of gene therapy, the cost of gene therapy, I reckon it's probably about 10 years off.
10 years, okay. And I guess the main question on everyone's lips is when we might be able to actually...
MAVA,
yes.
Mm. So, folks, you need to start writing to your MPs now. What I'm very afraid of is that, so we've been bitten by tafamidis in amyloid. So I showed you that drug, which has been shown to be effective in amyloid disease, but was turned down by NICE twice. And various reasons why that happened, but the bottom line was price. So tafamidis costs, for a year's therapy, it's about £85,000.
A lot of money.
It's a lot of money.
Mm.
Now, we don't know what the price of MAVA is going to be in the UK, but in the States, it's $89,000 for a year's therapy. Now, I can tell you now, that will not get through NICE. What we hope, and we're lobbying very hard with the company, is to say, please don't be greedy.
Mm.
Because if you come in and you're greedy, no one's going to use this drug. They can use it in the States because if you're rich, you get whatever you pay for in the States.
Yeah.
But in more public health systems like we have here, it's got to be much, much cheaper.
Yeah, sure.
So I don't know what's going to happen.
Be very disappointing, wouldn't it, to have this amazing new treatment available to us for the first time ever and then not be able to have it.
Not to be able to have it, and it's going to be backing up.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I showed you a slide about cancer treatments.
Mm.
They are all really expensive.
Yep.
So some of this is about, again, it's a culture change.
Mm.
Cancer treatments are often licensed on the basis that they hold the disease, not that they cure the disease.
Mm.
In cardiovascular trials, we've become obsessed by mortality improvement, which of course is an important goal, but so is being able to live better with your condition.
Most definitely not.
And I think we need a bit of a mindset change in the way in which we think about cardiac treatments.
Mm.
So I hope that MAVA and drugs like that are going to drive that change, but there's a bit of work to be done in persuading.
Yeah, we can't get too excited.
No, I'd get excited. No, you should get excited.
We can get excited.
You can get excited.
Okay, you'll let us get excited.
But we also need to get a bit...
realistic.
I was going to say ballsy, actually. We need to go... We need to advocate.
Okay.
And I think we can do... this organisation can do that.
Yes.
You guys can do that. One of the sad things about amyloid is that it affects frail, elderly people who don't have a voice in our society. If amyloid affected middle-aged lawyers, bankers, yeah, whatever, we'd have tafamidis.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really important for the charity and for people like yourselves with the disease to start the lobbying now.
So I know that we are as a charity,
yep.
but what can people do on a personal level to actually affect that change? Is it literally just about banging the drum?
It's about banging the drum, and it's writing to your MP mm-hmm. and saying, you know, I've got this, my family's got this. You know, what are the government doing about getting this drug on formulary? Because
mm-hmm.
unfortunately, sometimes the loudest voices win.
Always. That's fantastic. Thank you so much for answering those questions. I think it's really nice to do a slightly more informal question and answer session. But I think if we can go to questions from the floor now, and just to say, if you could try and keep the personal details of the question to a minimum, because we are recording, so try and take the personal details out. If you can, I know that's hard. But do we have any questions from the floor? My colleague Pete will come round with the microphone. There's quite a big room to get round, Pete, isn't it?
So on behalf of patients with HCM, we should be writing to our MPs about mavacamten. What should I be lobbying my MP about on behalf of DCM patients?
I think,
or in other words, what new drugs
yeah, what
are
would
coming
the priority
along
be?
That
yeah, it's a great question.
Might be held up by price.
Do you know what I think I would put top of my list of DCM at the moment is genetic testing. Because it's available, but is it being done for the majority of people with DCM? I suspect not. And already, without any fancy new drugs, I think the genotype has an influence on how you manage people, particularly around defibrillators. So I think a lobbying there would be, you know, to make sure that genetic testing is part of the routine workup of DCM. As new drugs come on, I can think of at least one or two companies that are going to start gene therapy next year around DCM. So if that becomes positive, then we need to start lobbying around those therapies. I think that's 12 months, 24 months off. But genetic diagnosis, I think, in DCM is something we need to push on.
Hi. Oh, sorry. Kind of a follow-up question to that. It's not something I've seen in CM UK magazines or anything, but I hadn't heard of this mavacamp, can't even pronounce it, drug until this morning. And it seems to me that actually if lobbying MPs is a good thing to do, then maybe that's something that can get publicised through the CM UK and just have, you know, in the magazines or by email, just say, okay, this trial has proved good results, or there is this therapy or this device, you know, please write to your MPs. And even for those of us that have different types of cardiomyopathy, it might just help in generally raising awareness among MPs around the country of cardiomyopathy mm. and potential treatments for it.
So I don't want to speak for the charity, but the charities will be one of the sort of expert groups, if you like, at the NICE hearing next year. And already the charity's done a piece of work looking at people's experience with obstruction, what having surgery does, you know, the good and the bad, to try to provide data to support the case for the drug at NICE. But yep, so I'm sure everybody's listening.
Thank you for an excellent talk and, you know, very inspirational and sort of mind-spinning. A lot of cardiomyopathy, as I understand it, is caused by a virus, or, you know, the underlying cause is viral. Has that been investigated, or is it just another way of saying we don't know?
No, exactly that, yeah. So it's certainly has been the common refrain that, yeah, you've got DCM, we don't know what the cause is, you probably had a little virus which caused this. And of course that's probably true in some people. The world of dilated cardiomyopathy has been split into three tribes for as long as I've been in this game. There's the genetic tribe, which is one I've come from, where it's all genetic, driven by it. There's the viral tribe. No, this is all about viral infections with common viruses that in some people cause very severe inflammation, and then you're left with DCM at the end of that. And then there's been the third tribe, which is this is all about immunity. abnormal immunity. So it's just in the same way as people get diabetes or thyroid problems because they've got an autoimmune disease, then dilated cardiomyopathy in some people is about autoimmunity, where the body's immune system is attacking the heart tissue. And of course, the truth is that everybody is right to a greater or lesser extent. So in many cases, just having the mutation alone is enough to give you the disease. In other cases, you're probably predisposed by having a genetic variation, but you need something on top of that to push you over. And that could conceivably be a viral infection, or pregnancy, or chemotherapy. You know, if you're predisposed to that damage, the extra trigger will push you over into DCM. And what we're also starting to see now is that some people do have evidence for activation of their immune system, which may be a driver. That's something we haven't characterized well, the role of the immune system. So I've spoken a lot today about gene therapies, about these new small molecule therapies, but I think another frontier that we're going to be seeing develop over the next few years is a renewed interest in inflammation in the heart, because there are drugs which are just sitting on the shelf already. We just need to work out which drug to use in the right person. So you know, the whole story of myocarditis is going to be important in cardiomyopathy as well, particularly, I think, in dilated.
Better put your running shoes on, Pete.
Or find a helper.
Yeah.
Thanks. Probably similar to the first question that was asked, what about treatments for ARVC?
Yep.
And also, are there any drugs that are coming onto the market that potentially have similar benefits to amiodarone but less of the side effects?
So I'll do the second one first. So amiodarone, there are amiodarone. So amiodarone is a domestos for all known arrhythmias, so it treats all kinds of arrhythmias. It's one of the few arrhythmic drugs that we really use now in everyday practice. But as you suggest, it is associated with side effects, most particularly sensitivity to the sun, abnormal thyroid. There are already amiodarone-like drugs that don't have those side effects. But they are, unfortunately, some of them are associated with poorer outcomes than amiodarone. So there's a reluctance to use those drugs unless one really has to. So I think amiodarone is going to maintain its place in a small number of individuals. Your first question is exactly aligned to everything I've said. So I probably should have said more about ARVC and gene therapy, but amongst the first gene therapy trials that I think we're going to see are going to be in ARVC to correct the underlying genetic defects that cause ARVC. There are some general issues about trials of gene therapy. I've mentioned some of them. One of them is how you construct the trial. Because it's very hard to do mortality trials in HCM. Because although, of course, people do die from these diseases, they don't die from them very often, fortunately. So to construct a trial where you want to get a survival benefit is quite hard. So they're going to be driven by things like quality of life or symptoms. Now, in ARVC, the focus is very much around arrhythmia and sudden death. And one of the things that the companies are struggling with is, if we give gene therapy, will we be able to convince or demonstrate to cardiologists that we've abolished the risk of sudden death or reduced it to the point where you don't need a defibrillator? That's going to be quite a hard thing to do, I think. I think what you can do in ARVC is to show proof of principle that gene therapy is doing something beneficial by giving it to people who already have defibrillators and showing a reduction in the use of their defibrillator. But it's a tricky one, ARVC, but it's there, it's on the menu already. The second interesting thing about ARVC is an answer to your point. ARVC in many people is an autoimmune disease. Inflammation is really important in ARVC. And we're starting to understand that a little better. And I can see us maybe developing new anti-inflammatory strategies in ARVC, as well as exploring things like gene therapy. So that just as in DCM and HCM, there's a lot of really interesting things, I think, about to happen. Yeah, try shouting. Yeah. I'm slightly audiologically challenged, but just speak loudly.
Is there any research going on or about to go on in relation to possibility of stress as a trigger? I know there's a specialist kind of type of cardiomyopathy, but I'm thinking across the broader range of cardiomyopathies.
Yeah, so ARVC is probably the best example of that. So arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. It has what we've called historically hot phases, where it's, you know, very quiet and all of a sudden you start to get lots of arrhythmia. Sometimes that's just spontaneous, sometimes it's triggered by exercise, but sometimes it's driven by physical or emotional stress. And that's where the inflammatory bit comes in. You know, if you stress the heart, you can probably activate its immune system. Now, in dilated cardiomyopathy, I think less certain. I would struggle to think of specific evidence where there's a clear relationship between stress and the development of the disease, other than sort of slightly strange things. I mentioned it to the HoCM group this morning. Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, octopus pot, which is a very specific, you may have heard about broken heart syndrome or stress cardiomyopathy, and it's a real thing. So you can get under intense stress that the heart can balloon. The reason it's called Takotsubo, or Japanese for octopus pot, is it resembles the shape of a Japanese octopus pot. But it resolves usually very quickly within 24, 48 hours. May not recur, much more common in women than it is in men. That's a very clear stress-related cardiomyopathy, but it's not quite the same idea as the ones we're talking about today.
Thank you very much. In this talk and the previous one, most of the drugs you mentioned have a specific functional role, either slowing down the heart or doing whatever they do.
Yep.
But there's one that seems to be given all the time, which I've never heard a functional role given other than statistically it seems to be better, and that is statins.
Yeah.
Do statins have a functional role?
In cardiomyopathy specifically?
Yeah.
No. No, so statins, they do no harm, so we know that. So that's been trialed, at least in dilated cardiomyopathy, that's been trialed. There was a theoretical reason for believing they might do harm. So while they're great at lowering your cholesterol and reducing your vascular risk, they potentially mess up the energetics of cells. But a trial was done to show that that doesn't happen. So they're safe to give in cardiomyopathy. But as far as we know, they don't have any particular benefit for the heart muscle bit. It's very much around vascular risk.
Okay. Thank you.
Go around that way.
Yeah, it's actually following that very same question. I know statins, when you read all the paperwork in them, there's an interaction with diltiazem.
Yes, with calcium antagonists, so they can increase the chances of getting muscle problems.
That might explain a lot.
Same with verapamil as well. Yeah. Come on. Really?
Hi, I don't want the people in the room with LVNC to feel left out here, so what's the opportunity in all this for LVNC?
So left ventricular non-compaction. What do you understand? I'll just bounce the question back to you for a second. What do you understand by left ventricular non-compaction?
Well, I've got it. My kids have got three kids, got the gene mutation.
Yep.
My son's heart at 21 is the exact same as mine.
Right.
So we are completely asymptomatic.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So this is, left ventricular is a tricky one. So it is, what it describes is if you look at all of our hearts, they're not smooth inside. They've got lots of little muscle bands that we call trabeculae. Left ventricular non-compaction means you've got more of that stuff. So it looks much more like, it's much more spongy, if you like. More like a loofah when it's extreme. And that's thought to be a developmental problem. So if you look at a baby's heart in the womb, all of our hearts start off like that. They all start off very spongy. And then that spongy stuff sort of conceptually compacts down and you're left with just this sort of layer of muscle bundles. But if that process arrests or doesn't go all the way, you're left with excessive trabeculation. And in some people, that is genetic. In some people, it can result in, if you like, an additional cardiomyopathy component to that. So some people have non-compaction with a thick heart, so it behaves more like hypertrophic. In some people, you can have this spongy stuff, the non-compaction, with a dilated heart, and there it behaves much more like dilated cardiomyopathy. The commonest place we see it, so if I want to go and show someone non-compactions, I take them down to the kids' hospital, to Great Ormond Street, and we just sit there in the echo meeting with all these kids who've got congenital heart problems, so holes in the heart or, you know, single ventricles, that sort of thing. They're all non-compacted, so it's because it's part of a developmental problem. So the first thing to say, it's not one thing. It's a spectrum of different kinds of heart muscle condition. The second problem is how you define it, how do you diagnose it? So if I sort of go back, I don't know, 15 years or so, there was an epidemic of non-compaction. Suddenly everybody was cardiologists diagnosing it all over the place. And the thing that was making it more common was MRI. Because it affects the tip of the heart, it's called the apex. And that's sometimes quite difficult to see on echo. But MRI shows it beautifully. So all these people, it was a normal variation. Just we hadn't seen it before. So there was a phase of over-diagnosis. So I always hesitate a little bit about non-compaction. I always want, you know, when it's like all things in life, when it's obvious, it's obvious. But at the fringes, you know, it can sometimes just be a manifestation of a normal heart. Or if you thicken the heart for other reasons, then these trabeculae can look normal. So people have suggested you can get non-compaction during pregnancy, which comes and goes. That's nonsense. You can't grow the heart and shrink it again, but you can thicken what's already there, and then that can then regress. So it's a long and windy answer, but non-compaction is a long and windy thing. You know, there's all sorts of caveats to it. But in your case, it sounds as though you have a genuine genetic cause for this appearance. The way in which we manage it, though, is determined by what else is happening in the heart muscle. Does that make sense? Right. I don't think there's a move to target non-compaction as an entity, but the same genes that cause DCM, HCM also cause non-compaction. So if we can prove the principle of gene therapy, then there's no particular reason why it couldn't be applied to non-compaction.
I think we have enough time for about two, possibly three questions, but probably sure. About two more. So.
Depends how long your answer is.
Just a quick one about the gene testing, actually.
Yeah.
How often should you be retested? Because my understanding is that they're finding new genes all the time. And I think it's been about 6 years since we did the 100,000 genome project as a family, and they didn't find anything that caused my daughter's DCM at that point. Is it worth redoing it now or wait a bit longer?
So genetic testing you can do at different levels. So you can just look at a limited panel of genes. And you're right, new genes come along. And if new genes come along and the original test was negative, then it's worth retesting. Okay. If you've had what was done in the 100,000 genome project, you've had your entire genetic code sequence.
We did, but we've not ever had an official feedback other than to say they didn't find anything.
Yes.
But we did ask there were 10 other things that they could look for if we chose to, which we did, and we've never heard anything about.
So if we genetically test anybody, there are going to be variations in a gene. Mm. And the question is, what is just normal variation and what is a cause for a disease? So even though the entire genetic code has been looked at, that's probably generated thousands of variations. And if you're looking at a new gene, there's a lot of things that then have to be done to say, well that one is maybe the candidate, now let's go and see if that's the cause. So again, I think The 100,000 Genome Project was a great thing. I think it raised expectations a little prematurely that it was, you just do 100,000 genomes, and we will find the cause. It's a bit more complicated than that.
Okay.
So I think as new genes come along,
going back to
the original results, absolutely.
And just Jenny be tested, obviously, they didn't find anything, so.
So if it, within your family, the person who's affected, who's been tested?
Only Jenny, and we've got four daughters, and there's nothing that we know of, you know, going upwards, grandparents, parents, so.
So it may not be non-genetic, it may be a gene which is yet to be described. Another genetic concept that's coming through now is that sometimes it's just a single genetic mutation that gives you a disease. But some people you may need a collection of relatively common variation in a gene, which together give you the disease. It's what's called polygenic risk. And we know that happens in high blood pressure, in coronary disease and diseases like that. It may also happen to a degree in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or dilated cardiomyopathy, that it's not a single gene, but it's the aggregate of multiple variations in different genes.
The autoimmune thing is interesting because we've actually got a lot of autoimmune in the family. So
maybe in your family that's the mechanism.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Can I just ask you, Perry, on the question of retesting for new genes? So is it up to us to push to be retested, or is there a process in place whereby when you find a new gene, you scan all the results that you already have?
So that's been a real problem because there is no sort of automated resequencing or retesting. Mm. The other problem that you face is that some variants, which maybe were originally thought to be benign, new information arises and now it's not so benign. Now that bit is improving. So the labs, as new information accrues, then it's a matter of informatics. You just need a system which, checks all the things again, said, no, we need to contact these people. But recall to do new genetic testing in cardiovascular is still one of the big problems.
Mm. Be good though, wouldn't it?
It would be good, yeah. But you need a system. It's, you know, I was moaning this morning about having to see too many people in the clinic. Can you hear what she's saying to me? But we can't keep seeing everybody forever. And at the moment, we use the outpatient clinic system to keep people on the books so that we can say, well, now we need to retest you. But that it just isn't feasible anymore.
Yeah. Any more?
We'll quickly try and squeeze one more in.
Thank you. Just very quickly. How far along is the regenerative therapy with synthetic lipid formulations? Is that quite far in sort of getting there? And
you mean, so
could it fix?
So instead of the virus to deliver, you mean a lipid molecule?
The synthetic lipid formulations. I'm a layman as far as I go, to be honest. So,
one answer to your question, which may be the wrong answer, is that if it relates to gene therapy, so gene therapy at the moment, we're tagging it to a virus which gets into the cell. But as I've said, that's tricky. The virus causes inflammation. Some people have got antibodies, it doesn't work. So people are looking at other carriers for delivery of therapy. And one is what we call lipid nanoparticles. So developing little small vehicles to carry cells. Unfortunately, they can also be toxic in high dose. So that's the answer I'm going to give you. I'm not sure it's the answer you wanted.
Well, I think we're at time. Well, I've also been told that when I speak, I need to be on the stage.
So, okay.
Just to say thank you, Perry. Thank you, Libby. It was really, really interesting. Thank you, everyone, for your questions as well. That was a really, really exciting session. So hopefully you will go away from today having learned something new and with a bit more hope for all of the things that are happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Pete.